I'm thrilled to have the opportunity to sit down and speak with the award-winning journalist, documentarian, news anchor, and producer, Ms. Soledad O'Brien. Ms. O'Brien juggles many roles and responsibilities, from CEO to mother of four. Ms. O'Brien began her career as a producer and news writer before moving on to become an anchor and a contributor on several major television networks. She's reported breaking news from around the world and produced award-winning and critically acclaimed documentaries on some of the most important issues in today's society. In 2013, Ms. O'Brien founded Starfish Media Group, a multimedia production and distribution company. She created this to provide a platform to tell empowering stories on a range of social issues. Here, she originated the successful documentaries Black in America and Latino in America. She currently anchors and produces the Hearst Television political magazine program, Matter of Fact, with Soledad O'Brien. Together, Ms. O'Brien and her husband have formed the Powerful Foundation. This nonprofit organization helps bridge the gap of opportunities for young minority women from low-income families so that they can attend college with financial assistance, mentoring, and a holistic support system so they can earn a degree and be on the path to success. Ms. O'Brien, welcome, and thanks for speaking with us today.
Thank you.
As you know, our graduates are a little different than traditional college students. They're working professionals who juggle many responsibilities. And while many people know you graduated from Harvard University, they might be surprised to know that you went back to school as a working adult. Can you share a little about your higher education experience?
Yeah, you know, I think like a lot of the Walden University students, they're non-traditional students, which sometimes just means older,
right.
Which I was. I took a 15-year gap because I had started working. And actually, I think it made me a better student in a lot of ways because I had a very finite amount of time. I was working while I was trying to get my degree. I was lucky because NBC, where I was working, actually paid for my degree. I went to finish my degree where I had started at Harvard University. It all worked out, but I do think being influenced by being in the job market already, kind of having a life, certainly having, you know, a credit card so I could skip the dining hall and actually kind of schedule my life around the stuff that I was doing, because I had a full career in life, made it in some ways challenging, but also made it easier in some way. I mean, I felt like I was a very focused student the second time around.
So I think a lot of working adults who are thinking about going to get an advanced degree, they probably experience some level of anxiety or apprehension. What advice might you give them?
You know, I guess it's the same advice Oprah used to give people about losing weight, which is like, it's the 5 years from now is coming anyway. So it's more about what you want to accomplish in that 5 years. You can't sit around and be stressed about your age or the time that's going to pass, or, you know, is it, you know, will you be X years old by the time you get that degree? It really has to be, what do I want to get to by this point in life? And I've always been pretty strategic and kind of had very tangible goals that I wanted to check off. So I, for me, it was just, you know, I knew I was pregnant actually when I went back to school, so I knew that I had to get that degree before I actually had a kid, because it would make things much more challenging to actually have a child and try to do what I was doing. So I knew that was my goal and I wanted to check it off.
Can you share with us a little about the Powerful Foundation that you and your husband founded several years ago?
Yeah, the inspiration comes from a story that I'll tell about a documentary I did in Haiti, which was, we were looking at missionaries who'd gone into Haiti really before the earthquake and after, and were running orphanages. And when I would talk to them about how they worked in a place that seemed so challenging, where they had 58 orphans, which was not a very large number, and 450,000 orphans. And I would say to them, you know, like, why, is this worth it? I mean, you know, like, are you doing enough? Isn't it just not enough? And they used to say, oh, Soledad, you know the starfish story. And I said, I have no idea what the starfish story is. Starfish story is a boy is walking along the beach. The tide's gone out and all these starfish have been beached on the sand. And so this boy starts picking up starfish and throwing them back in the water to save their lives. And a man comes up to him and says, what are you doing? This beach goes on for miles. There are literally a million starfish on this beach. This is a complete waste of time. And the boy picks up a starfish and says, well, I guess it mattered to this one, and chucks it. And so from that, we started a foundation that would focus on taking individuals and help them become successful. How can you sort of fill them with all the things that they needed to be successful, very much in what I thought that the folks we were interviewing for our doc were doing. And we decided to focus on young women. I felt like I'd been a young woman. I knew a little bit of something about that.
Sure.
And we knew that if we could give young women who were especially in poverty and maybe didn't necessarily have all the tools around them to be successful, but if we could wrap them in mentoring and really good advice and also just picking them up when things went south. You know, for a lot of people, I think their failure sometimes is more like death by a thousand paper cuts. You blow a tire in your car, you can't afford to fix it, you stop going to class because you're not going to class, you failed that class because you failed that class, you don't get to, you know, finish out that semester. That means that the money that you borrowed is no longer, no more access to it, which means that now you can't afford college anymore, but you have this massive debt. I mean, and that's not a, I mean, you know better than I would know, that's a very typical situation. I've just seen it a lot personally. So we were trying to figure out how can you help people with the things that they need. And writing a check is fantastic, but it's not everything. People need a lot of very tangible support. So we started Powerful. We go to cities around the country. We've been to Tampa, actually, which was a city we love, and we and find young women who just want to be successful but might lack the tools.
So clearly, gender equity is important to you. And we're at a watershed moment right now when it comes to women in the workplace. What opportunities do you think exist for women as a result of that?
Yeah, you know, it'll be interesting to see where we are in this very weird and awkward conversation and necessary conversation about opportunities for women and how women can really navigate a workplace without, you know, being harassed verbally, physically. I think the Time's Up movement, which was the Me Too movement, is really an interesting sort of, we're at the start of that, and it'll be interesting to see where it goes. Big picture, I just think there's obviously a lot more opportunities for women. I mean, you look at journalism in general, you know, I'm old enough to know that, you know, when Barbara Walters started, you know, there were just not really a lot of opportunities. And she literally had to fight her way into the things that she wanted to achieve and accomplish because sort of that sense of, well, women aren't allowed to do that. Even when I was reporting, there was a lot of sense that if you were a mom, you wouldn't want to go to Southeast Asia to cover the tsunami. You know, you might be too emotional. And a producer once said to me, you know, if you can't handle this, we're going to put you back on a plane. And I was like, and I was 35. I'm really thinking, like, I do not need help getting on a plane, either to come here or to leave. But, you know, the patronizing tone of somehow that I might not be able to hack it when I was thinking, you know, listen, I have delivered a child with no drugs. Let me, you know, you do that, and then we will talk about someone's capacity to handle something. I think a lot of those conversations have changed, and when I was starting out, it was really important to me to be the face of that, right? I really wanted to travel to say, like, I'm a mom, I have four kids, I travel all the time. Is it hairy and crazy sometimes? Sure. But this is what I want to do if I want to have the career that I want to have. And I was hopeful that other young women could see that they had options. Not everybody likes to travel, but I do. I like to travel a lot, actually. So I was just, you know, it was doable. If you wanted to travel and you had kids, here was an example of someone who was doing it at a pretty high level.
So you've talked about the changes that have taken place. What do you hope will change for future generations of women? Where are we going?
I think for future generations of people, where I hope we're going is that the workplace doesn't become this combative like location. I mean, the workplace should just be that all the best people come and work together as a team and respect each other. I mean, sometimes some of these conversations that we've been reading about in the press is like the rule is the same rule I have in my house, which is don't touch the other people. Right? Like, do not touch your brothers and leave them hands to yourself. Touch no one.
Right.
You know, do your work. Focus on you. Be your best self. Like, it's kind of the basic rules. And it reminds me of, you know, like circle time in pre-K. Is, you know, don't touch your neighbor. Focus on what the teacher is telling. You know, sit still. Try not to squirm. I don't know how we've gotten to a place where so many people clearly have felt, you know, victimized in their own workplace. I mean, really, as much as I'm joking in some ways, it's terrible. It's horrific. So I just hope we get to a place that I think most reasonable people would say is the way the workplace should be. It shouldn't be, people shouldn't be angry and anxious about going to work. They should feel like they can go in there and do their best work and be creative and bring their best selves and work with people that they like, who respect them and that they respect, even if they disagree. I mean, it's a little bit of a microcosm of the world. I don't think that's asking a lot.
You've also devoted a lot of energy throughout your career to telling stories about social injustice and inequality. You challenge people to have these difficult conversations. What's motivated you to pursue these empowering stories?
You know, we're at an interesting time. There's such a hostile anti-immigrant sentiment in this country and very overt hostility. It's, you know, so as a child of immigrants, I mean, I just feel like the tenor and the tone requires people to step up and just talk about their experiences. There was an article I was reading this morning from a local paper in Maine, where the town manager, a tiny town that has 900 people, clearly talking about his white supremacist views. I mean, it was done like a normal, like swapping recipes. I mean, the most normalized conversation. I think people have to say, like, this is not okay. And there's this atmosphere that is just not what I think are the American ideals that we've long talked about and people have fought over and died for. So I for me, my perspective is you just have to have a voice. And what I hope to talk to the graduates today about is, you know, this idea that part of the responsibility is speaking up and seeking to know other people and seeking to understand other people and sharing your own story. Because I don't think there's any other way for people to truly get some of these complicated issues than to understand and really know people at a deeper level. You know, that to me is why I've always tried to stick up for the things that I think are wrong. It's funny, last night there was a young woman, beautiful girl, who was recounting on Twitter how somebody had called her a slur as she was walking down the street, drive by in a car. I mean, imagine, she must be 21 years old or something. And they said something about her slanty eyes. And she said, I'm looking in the mirror right now trying to see what's wrong with my eyes. I mean, can you, it broke my heart. Like, there's nothing wrong with your eyes. There is nothing wrong. By the way, beautiful, lovely, clearly smart young woman. How is it possible in 2018 that this young woman is doubting herself because somebody has rolled up on a car to throw a racial slur her way? You know, so I invited her out for a drink because that's, I said to her, here's what we do. Here's what you do. Literally, you know, go and put your chin up and have a glass of wine and move forward. And I think that's the kind of advice my mom gave me, right? You move forward and keep going and try to make the world a better place in spite of some people who are doing some really crazy things.
So you speak about your mom and you talk about your experiences. How have your own experiences shaped the stories and the series that you produce?
I always thought when we started Black in America, which was a big series for CNN, which launched in 2008, that people's take on these sort of communities that were very rarely reflected in the news, and actually very few people who were working in the newsroom came out of those communities, was just often wrong. For example, when we did our Latino in America story documentary, the number of people who have come to this country where their parents didn't speak English, but so they became, as a six-year-old or seven-year-old, the translator for their parents, has a really interesting impact on kind of how you navigate the world. For some people, they grow up very fast, right? You're navigating with Con Ed because your parents can't. In some ways, they would pull fast ones, you know, do an absolute fake translation to their parents about what their, you know, high school principal was saying. But it's an interesting element. And, you know, kind of those kinds of stories were just really sort of ignored. So I knew we could bring in more interesting stories because my mom is Cuban, my dad is Australian. They've had an interesting journey through America at a time when interracial marriage was illegal. And there were just a bunch of stories that I think actually now we're starting to see people say, there are these whole communities that have these really interesting stories. You know, maybe there's value in telling those stories. Maybe there's money in telling those stories, right? Maybe there's audiences who would love to see those stories, and not just little siloed audiences, but people who are interested in that kind of storytelling. That movie that's out, I think it's up for an Academy Award, The Big Sick, right, which is about an immigrant and his immigrant family and his girlfriend who's white and she gets sick. I could relate a lot to that dynamic without being a comedian whose girlfriend got sick. So I think there's a tremendous value in those stories.
So a lot of our students work in professions that require a calling, things like social work or nursing or teaching, and they're trying to make a difference in their community. What advice might you give one of those individuals?
You know, I realistically think the first advice is to take care of yourself. I think it's very easy when you're in a caring profession, like a nurse or social work, being a first responder in any way, is really easy to be on the treadmill of help, 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 and just deplete yourself. So my first advice is always, you know, make sure that you're healthy. People use the lame analogy, which is a good analogy, but a lame analogy of, you know, the oxygen comes off and there's, you know, you got to help yourself with the, and then put the mask on and then turn to people because you're kind of useless if you're passing out while you're trying to help people. And I think there's some truth to that, right? You actually have to be in a position to really care for people. Otherwise, you're not actually serving them at the best level that you could. So number one, I would say, really take care of yourself. And then number two, to remember, you know, kind of keep an eye on the mission. Remember what you're doing this for. Remember why you're here. Any issues can be solved, but keep an eye on the big picture of what you got into this for.
So a lot of folks today would say in our country, we're living in a time of divisiveness.
You think?
What could we do to build bridges in our local communities or even in our workplaces?
I think it's got to be a two-front solution. So first, I think if you're going to build bridges, you have to make sure that you're having conversations with people who also want to build bridges, right? It can't be, I don't think screaming at people works, but I also don't think capitulating on things works all the time either, right? You have to be able to call out people who are being hateful and being horrible. I mean, I'm a big believer in, like, what are the facts of the issue? I mean, that's, you know, you've got to hold people accountable for what they're talking about. But you also have to have spaces where people can come together and talk about why they think the things that they think. I mean, in a way, we're in trouble today because we have very siloed approaches to politics, to news, to even any kind of content, right? It can all, Facebook will send you exactly what you want all the time. You're never necessarily dragged out of your space unless you opt into it. So I think you do have to just provide forums, opportunities for those conversations. And I think, again, a message that I have for the students at graduation is you have to share your story. You know, you have to be able to talk about what you've done and what you've accomplished and how hard it was and what sucked about it. I mean, right? I mean, this idea that it's all easy breezy, I don't think is inspiring to people. I think showing people how challenging things are, but that working hard at it can ultimately lead to success is critical.
So many of our new graduates are here for career advancement or maybe to take a new direction in their career. What's the one thing you wish someone would have told you when you left broadcasting to start your own company?
You know, I wish that there had been someone who could have advised me to actually use the time that I had. I knew a couple of years before I left that I would be leaving doing day-to-day television. One, it's exhausting, but also it just wasn't really going the direction that I wanted to go. I wish I'd taken classes in accounting and negotiation and all these things that actually you need to have as a CEO. I mean, I'd never really worked on a budget before. I was, you know, talent. I was a reporter and an anchor. There were so many things that I didn't know how to do. And I wish I'd used my time when I even thought, like, you know, maybe if in a few years from now I won't be doing this very thing, to go gather new skills. You know, I really wish that I had done that. And, you know, because all you have to do is do your first budget and be way, 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 way off and find yourself working on a project where you're losing money every day because your budget was bad to make you realize, like, wow, an accounting class probably would have saved us a lot of this pain. Sure. I was at an event last night and this CEO of a large plastics manufacturing plant was talking about a mistake that he made that cost the company $1 million. And I felt very good about my mistake, which did not cost us $1 million. You see it as a consistent, right, among people who come into a business and don't know something, right? You learn on the job, and it can be costly. I wish that I had done those things to make that transition easier.
So if you could only offer one piece of advice to a new college graduate, what would that be?
You know, I think, and I'll sort of say this today in my talk, I think for most college graduates, everybody weighs in on what they can do and should do and can't do and shouldn't do and will never do and can't accomplish. I think that for college grads, it's like figure out what you want to do and then go and do it. These things are very tactical. They're very strategic. Deconstruct how someone else has done it and then figure out the steps to get there. And don't worry so much about the noise of people telling you, you know, this is the kind of thing that you can never do. I've had so many people who I'll meet at events who'll say, you know, I always wanted to be a journalist or I studied journalism, but I just never thought that and I think, what? There's a gajillion people in journalism and there's so many opportunities to work in journalism. It's just sad that you took yourself out of the running for something because people said, it's not going to pay well. There are not a lot of jobs. There's not much that you can do. You're not pretty enough to go be on TV. You'll never anchor a show. Those are all literally things that I've heard, and that's just so silly. So I guess my one piece of advice would be don't listen so much to advice. Be more strategic and navigate your way to something that you're very passionate about and surround yourself with people who are cheerleaders and truth tellers, you know, tell you when you're not doing what you need to be doing, but also help you get to that thing that you want to do very much.
So Soledad, thank you for being here with us
today. My pleasure.
It's been a pleasure to get your insights and your experiences and to share those with our Walden community. We wish you continued success in all of your projects and in your foundation.
Thank you.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for talking to me.